can remember when I was 3 and 4 and 5 picking up pencils and sketching, copying things from magazines. I'm not sure I can say why I did. It just always appealed to me. There was no doubt in my mind from a very early age that I was destined to get caught up being an artist.
I don't think there's a portrait painter that's better than Everett since John Singer Sargent. And it's that good.
Tony introduced me to Everett, and then I saw some of Everett's work, and I thought, oh, this is just fabulous. And then Everett said that he would do me. I was dumbfounded.
We heard so many good things about him. I decided that he would be my choice, at least, to do my presidential portrait.
I didn't give a damn about prestige. I wouldn't have cared if nobody had known about him. I was looking for a painter who is a real craftsman, who really is a master of his profession.
I would like to be regarded as a person who is an artist who paints portraits. And every portrait I paint, I would like to feel that my colleagues would say, that's a good painting. Because see, we don't know how much Sargent's Madame X looked like Madame X, nor Frans Hals's Borgers looked like those tradespeople in Holland, or Rembrandt's self-portraits, but it's the way they will be remembered.
Ray started out as an illustrator, and he started out at a time when there was no television, and there was a tremendous popularity of not only comic books, but also pulp magazines.
The beauty of being an illustrator, a successful one, and I was just a low kid on the ladder, never made it up to the top. The ability to be a good illustrator was, number one, you had to be there. You had to be there, you had to feel it. That's what made Pyle and Wyeth and Dean Cornwell such great illustrators. They felt it, they felt the pirates. They felt Treasure Island. They felt the cowboy. They felt the romantic. They were there, here, here. And that's what I think you have to do as an artist. I don't care which way direction you're taking it, abstract, realism, abstract, nature, whatever. We're all abstractionists. I start very simply with abstract shapes. But can you get a feeling of what it is that turns you on?
He's a natural portrait painter. Natural as could be. That's why I think he's so great. He can connect with people very quickly. That's important as a portrait painter. You have to connect with a personality, and Everett connects with a personality. And people who pose for him like him, you know. They enjoy him. So there's a wonderful relationship between the painter and the person being painted.
Anyway, Dean Cornwell, who was a very close friend of Flagg's. In fact, Dean and I gave the eulogy when Flagg died in 1960. Dean Cornwell had gotten very, very involved, Tom, with the work of a man I think was one of the great, great American illustrators named Harvey Dunn.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
D-U-N-N.
Yeah.
And everything Cornwell did was aping Dunn to the point they couldn't tell him apart. And Flagg got off this line, which was memorable. Dean was Dunn before he was Dean.
While he paints, he always talks. I think he probably, if you put a duct tape over his mouth, I'll bet he can't paint. I don't think he can paint without talking. Maybe he can while he's by himself, but I'll bet you he engages in soliloquy.
In fact, it's often hard to keep the same expression on your face because you're bound to be smiling at the stories he tells.
Makes you very comfortable. You don't have to sit there like, don't move. You know, you can talk and giggle and, you know, and then he'll say, okay, hold still just for a second. Then he'll do some magic and there he is.
What I've learned about anyone who's humorous, very, very humorous, not just comics, but just humorous about what they're doing, is that they know what they're doing like the back of their hand. They're that familiar with it. They know their craft, they know what they're doing, and they have room to have a great sense of humor about it.
Everett would be the first to point out that he is not just a portrait painter. He is a painter, he's an artist first. He needs to be as active in painting landscapes as he is in painting figures. And you can see in the body of work he has created that he lives up to that that expectation.
I feel it's very important for me, my development, my stimulation, my challenge to paint out of doors wherever possible. Working in your studio, you're bound to repeat yourself. Your temperature, palette, light stays the same, always the north light. By painting out of doors, you're painting different moods, different effects, different colors, different temperatures, and their effect upon one another, and they're always changing. It's also for me, it's almost a religious experience. I'm not a religious person, but you lose sense of sight of time and space, and it cleanses you totally because you're absorbed in studying things that you, to the average person, passes all the time and never stop to look at. And so when you're faced with painting a particular scene, or cactus, or rocks, you study them. What can you look at for 2 hours? You do.
Well, his landscapes are terrific. Whenever he does a landscape, he really gets the feeling of the atmosphere and the feeling of the structure of the place. It's quite wonderful, quite beautiful. And he does it very spontaneously, which is nice too. That's the way he works.
In his lifetime, Kinstler watched illustration fall from fashion. And during the time when the modern art movement had all but extinguished interest in traditional art forms, Kinstler persevered. His portraits reflect American history over the past five decades. His body of work reflects one of America's greatest contributions to art.
What I love about his thinking is that he has respect for all the old masters. He sees that this is the way they did it, and it's just common sense. If they hit the top, like a Rembrandt, like a Michelangelo, like a Sargent, like a Sorolla, he kind of lives with their technique and their way of doing things. I love that. I love that because, you know, if the old cliche, but a very correct one, if you don't know the past, how could you know the future?
I have a mistress, and that mistress is daylight. When the light comes up, I am moving. When the light goes down, I stop. I work, and I don't have the ability to stop for an hour or two and go back and work again. I get that momentum going, and that is focus.